last night I finished reading, or rather listening to the audiobook of The Mists of Avalon by Marion Zimmer Bradley. I'd been meaning to read it for a long time because first I saw the miniseries that was made back in 2001, I want to say, but yeah, and so I loved the movie version, and I've been meaning to read the book for a long time, and I saw they had it on Audible as an audiobook, and considering the book is so long, about 900 pages, I prefer, if a book's really long and if they have it as an audiobook, I prefer audiobooks, just because it's nice to, it feels like story time as a little kid, you know, you're sitting there like, read me a story, and somebody reads it to you, and you can just sit and chill and listen to the story. So yeah, these are my thoughts on The Mists of Avalon. Now, The Mists of Avalon deals with the legends of King Arthur, and even if you aren't really into the stories of King Arthur, through popular culture you will have heard of various things from the legends. You know, King Arthur, Lancelot, Guinevere, their love triangle, King Arthur's sword Excalibur, the Round Table, the Knights of the Round Table, the Lady of the Lake, Merlin, all these wonderful, fantastic elements that have soaked into popular culture. So even if you don't know the Arthurian legends well, there will be things in the story, in The Mists of Avalon, that you will recognize. But what's interesting about The Mists of Avalon is it tells the story of the Arthurian legends from the perspectives of the women in King Arthur's life. So at first it starts off with King Arthur's mother Igraine, and then there'll be chapters told from the point of view of his wife Guinevere, but mostly it focuses on King Arthur's half-sister Morgaine, or Morgan le Fay as she's known in other versions. It focuses on Morgaine's story and her journey, and so the exploits of the knights and King Arthur, those sort of are put on the back burner as we deal with the women in the story and what their experiences are. What's so fascinating about The Mists of Avalon is the main conflicts are cultural and spiritual clashings. The indigenous culture, at least the one that's set up in the book, I don't know much about that actual time in history, that's in England after the Roman Empire leaves and leaves England to its own devices. But the indigenous culture that's set up in the book is a matriarchal culture. It's a pagan spirituality centered around nature and the idea of the earth as the mother goddess. The goddess has a consort, the horned god, who would probably then be known as Cernunnos, I believe, was the name of the Celtic horned god. He would be the Celtic equivalent of Pan, the Greek horned god of nature. So there's that culture. And the clashing of the patriarchal Roman culture and the rise of Christianity, and a very specific type of Christianity. Not the Christianity where Christians and pagans worship side by side and can get along. There's actually, and this is based on actual mythology that's still in England today, that there are legends that a young Jesus, when he was 12 years old, in between the times in the Bible where we don't know really what happened to him, it doesn't say in the Bible, it just says he was 12 years old, and then in the Bible it jumps ahead to, and then Jesus was 20, in his late 20s or early 30s, and was starting to preach around his native homeland after being away for a long time, so we don't know where he went. But the legend centers around a young Jesus coming to Britain with his uncle, Joseph of Arimathea. And so based on those legends, for a time, the Christians and the pagans could get along and worship side by side and all that good stuff. But once Bishop Patricius, who would later become Saint Patrick, came to England and started preaching, he was very patriarchal and very much, no, there's only one God, only one brand of Christianity, and that's the way I see things. And if you don't see it the way I see it, you're not a real Christian. You're going to go to hell. All the wonderful, lovely things that were associated with Christian bigotry back then and are associated with Christian bigotry today. And those two sides are illustrated by Morgaine and Guinevere. Morgaine is King Arthur's half-sister. They have the same mother, Igraine. And Morgaine is, the book focuses on her being raised on the mystical, magical island of Avalon as a priestess of the old religion. And she's taught to do magic. She's taught herb lore and spells and all this cool, wonderful, fantastical elements that, and what's interesting about how Zimmer Bradley handles it in the book is it's not really seen as supernatural elements, but it's treated more as everyone has those gifts inside, and through training and studying and meditation, you can unlock those gifts and learn these arts and magical arts and all those things. So Morgaine is on the side of the pagan culture, the traditional culture of her people, and Guinevere, on the complete opposite side, was raised in a nunnery from the time when she was a little girl, and so she grew up in the very strict patriarchal, the very strict new brand of patriarchal Christianity that's sweeping across the land. And Guinevere is really annoying because of that. She's like that. She quotes the Bible every 10 sentences. Her perspective on the world is very narrow-minded, very much. And it's really sad. On the one hand, you pity her because you know that she's conditioned to think that way since she was a little girl. She's conditioned to think women are evil, and she was evil because she's a woman, even as a naive young girl, she's done nothing wrong, but she thinks she's done wrong because she's a woman and women are evil because Eve was evil, blah, 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 all this stuff that fanatical right-wing Christians tend to believe. So those are the major plot conflicts of the story. Pagan versus Christian, matriarchy versus patriarchy, indigenous Celtic culture versus Roman culture, all that good stuff. So if that's something that interests you, you'll love the plot and all the twists and turns it takes. And that's really all I can say without going into stuff that could be spoilers. But I can also mention here twists on the traditional tellings of the Arthurian legend that I really enjoyed in this book. And keep in mind, the Arthurian legends have been told time and time and time again. So it's not like there's one official original version, although you could say Malory's Le Morte d'Arthur is like the first official canon. But anyway, I love the idea of where Avalon came from. And again, this is revealed fairly early on in the book, so it's not really a spoiler. But Avalon in the book is described as being sort of in between the worlds, and the people who know the magic arts and who know how to navigate through the mists that shroud the lake can get there. But as Christianity comes and more people start turning away from magic and the traditional beliefs, Avalon starts to drift away further and further into the mists. So that's a neat idea. I like that idea. But what's also a really fascinating element is where Avalon, or rather where the first Avalonians came from. And it's revealed in the book that they are the survivors of Atlantis, and that Atlantis sank because they got too greedy with their technology, and so the gods sank the island, and the last few people who managed to survive washed up onto the island of Avalon. And that's a fascinating idea, taking two legends that have been around for hundreds of years and tying them together. That's a fascinating idea. And I love the notion of Merlin being a title, not a name. So instead of just calling him Merlin, it's the Merlin. And the Merlin is the highest druidic high priest. And to see different men fill that role and how they each handle the responsibilities of it. And the fact that the first Merlin we meet in the book is Taliesin, who is a figure from Celtic mythology who was the rock star of his day. He was the best bard ever known all throughout England, and that was interesting. And then I also, getting into a character I loved Kevin. Kevin was the second Merlin, and things don't end well for him. Anyone who knows Arthurian legends and who knows what happens to Merlin at the end of his life. And the book is divided into different books. Like each book has a certain title, and the last book is called The Prisoner in the Oak Grove. So yeah, anyone who knows the Arthurian legends can guess what happens to Kevin based on that. And it doesn't end well, but how it happens is just so sad. I was like, Kevin, no! Even though I knew it was coming based on the title, it's like, damn it, no, not Kevin. But so yeah, I love the idea of Merlin being a title, and both the Merlins in the book, Taliesin and Kevin, are awesome. What other twists on the Arthurian legend did Zimmer Bradley take in this story? Well, a very infamous plot element between Arthur and Morgaine. In most traditional tellings, that element happens because Morgaine is completely spiteful and uses Arthur out of a want for revenge, and in the Mists of Avalon, the elements of that plot point unfold as a completely tragic accident where, I mean, it's not an accident, it's carefully manipulated and planned out by other characters in the story, but Morgaine and Arthur are both completely innocent victims for that plot device, which is a wonderfully refreshing take on it. And it was actually I first saw the miniseries before I read the book, and seeing the miniseries is really my first introduction into the Arthurian legends. We watched the first 45 minutes of it in my 11th grade English class. We couldn't watch the whole thing because it's 3 hours long, but we watched the first half hour or so, and it was my real introduction into the Arthurian legends. So then later, when I saw other more quote-unquote traditional tellings of the story that make Morgaine out to be the straight-up villain, I'm like, no, I like the Mists of Avalon take on it, where she's as much a pawn of fate as Arthur is, and how their bond is so close, and how really they form such a strong bond that you can tell that in past lifetimes. And that's another theme that the book deals with, is the idea of reincarnation and who these different characters, who they may have been to each other in past lives. But it's clear that she and Arthur were lovers in a past life, but in this lifetime they obviously can't be a couple outright because they're half siblings in this story. Another great twist that's put into the novel concerns the love triangle between King Arthur, his wife Guinevere, and his best friend and best knight, Sir Lancelot. In most adaptations, King Arthur doesn't find out about the affair that's gone on between Guinevere and Lancelot until it's been going on for years. But in the Mists of Avalon, he knows about it and he looks the other way for years because he knows how unhappy his wife is, even though she's the frickin' Queen of England and can have anything she wants, and her religion and culture is dominating and pushing out all the other religions and cultures. So yeah, I don't know what the hell she has to complain and whine and bitch about, but oh, that's just who Guinevere is. I'm sorry, she just really irritates me. I mean, I don't think since the Duchess Josiana in The Man Who Laughs have I found a character in a book so irritating and just so self-righteous and just so, I want to punch you in the face because you can have everything you want and yet for some reason you're still not satisfied with your life and feel like you're a poor soul who needs to be pitied and like, oh, I don't have everything I want because I can't have this one thing. The main difference between Josiana and Guinevere is Josiana is a self-righteous nut job because she was born into royalty and therefore taught to have everything she wants at a moment's notice, and she's pretty. Guinevere is a self-righteous nut job because she was born into royalty and is pretty and was raised in a strict convent. So yeah, being a self-righteous fanatic religious nut job is a whole other level of crazy as opposed to being a self-righteous nut because you were just born as an aristocrat and taught that with a wave of your hand you can get whatever you want. But that's a whole other video. I've been meaning to do the Man Who Laughs review anyway, but that's another video for another day. Not only that, not only is it compelling to know that Arthur knows about the affair, but the motives behind the affair as far as Lancelot is concerned. Lancelot is a pretty boy in the Mists of Avalon. Every girl wants him. Every girl wants to be with him. Every girl wants to catch his eye. But he doesn't notice any girl until Guinevere. And it's because Guinevere is betrothed to Arthur. And plot twist, Lancelot is actually in love with Arthur. And he goes after Guinevere because he can't come to grips with himself being homosexual. He feels like, well, I can't have Arthur, so Guinevere's the next best thing, the closest thing to Arthur because she's married to Arthur and has been with Arthur. So that's a great twist on the love triangle is Lancelot doesn't want Guinevere, he wants Arthur. And maybe Arthur might want Lancelot too, but that's never really directly stated. Guinevere confronts him about it and he mentions, no, it's just the solidarity of comrades in arms. And not that two people of the same gender can't have a strong platonic bond and there's nothing sexual about it at all. But considering how many adaptations have been just the basic love triangle of both Lancelot and Arthur want Guinevere, it's interesting to see a different twist on it where it's like they don't want Guinevere for Guinevere, they want Guinevere because she's literally, and I mean literally, in between, in a certain scene in the book, she's in between the two men and is sort of the gateway for them having each other. Now on to the things that I thought could have been improved with the book. Given that it's so big, I think that the time jumps were a bit sloppy. One chapter would deal with an entire day and tell what each character was doing in that day and what they were wearing and what they had for breakfast. And then in the next chapter, the narrative would keep flowing and you wouldn't realize that it was 3 years later until one character mentioned to another, oh, don't you remember that event character's name? Don't you remember that event that the audience just read about? Well, that was 3 years ago. And so, yeah, the time jumps were sloppy because you couldn't tell at certain points when things were taking place. So I think that could have used an editor's notes. And I also think a map would have been helpful so we could figure out where different places are in relation to each other. Like, for instance, where's Camelot in relation to London? Where's London in relation to Avalon? Where's Avalon in relation to the entirety of England? Those sorts of things that could have been helpful. And also a family tree, definitely, because this story is so much rooted in family affairs and family events, which is true to the original take on Arthurian legends. For instance, Morgan and Arthur have been related since who knows how long, but Morgan and Arthur are also the cousins of Lancelot through the Lady of the Lake, who is Lancelot's mother. And I think that the Lady of the Lake being Arthur and Morgan's aunt is a strictly Mists of Avalon thing. I don't remember that in any other adaptation. And simply the fact that so many people are related, who weren't related in the traditional tellings, I think was a flaw in the book. It just seemed unnecessary in the book. You could have had all the same drama unfold if certain people weren't related but just interacted with each other because they were both members of Arthur's court. For instance, the love triangle thing with Lancelot and Guinevere and Arthur, I think it would have been enough of a twist if it was just Lancelot's gay and he loves Arthur. You didn't have to add the element of Lancelot's in the closet and he loves Arthur. Oh, and they're also cousins. That's also a thing. That felt like it didn't need to be there, that it was just there just because. Unless certain family ties are in the original tellings of the story, and I just didn't realize it. But other than the giant tangled family tree and the weird time jumps, the book was really well written. It really kept me interested. I was really anxious to see what was going on. The characters were really well fleshed out. Some of them did fall into stereotypes or into tropes, but in the grand scheme, they made sense. But those are really my only critical notes. So the book is fantastic. The miniseries is wonderful. I have to say, as far as the miniseries and the book, I like the miniseries a lot. I enjoyed the book as well. There are certain elements that, now that I read the book, I wish made it into the miniseries. For instance, Kevin. Kevin was a great character. I don't think they had to cut him out. And certain plot elements that I can't really talk about without going into spoilers, but I think for a miniseries, yes, they cut out a lot compared to the book, but it wasn't as bad. The miniseries still stands well on its own as its own thing and still gets the messages of the book across, which deal with spiritual tolerance on both sides. In both the miniseries and the book, they're both Christian fanatics and pagan fanatics who can't envision a world where their faiths coexist alongside another faith. So it's a great balancing act. It's not like, oh, just the right-wing Christians are bad, or oh, the right-wing pagans are bad. It shows, no, both sides have their fanatics, and it shows at the end that we have to come together and realize that all spiritual paths, as long as they inspire love and kindness, they all lead to the same place and come from the same place. And it deals with the dynamics of men and women. And what I found interesting about the book is so many people are like, oh, it's a classic of feminist literature. And reading the book, I don't really see that. I mean, I see it as feminist in the sense that it's arguing for a more egalitarian society where men and women are seen as equal and have equal responsibilities in society, and how it's arguing for women's spirituality, of bringing the goddess back into spirituality, into Western spirituality, because spirituality in the Western world for so long has been so patriarchal and so damaging to both genders because of that. If men and women are both told you each only have a certain role to play, that can be damaging to both sides. And so so the book definitely argues for the masculine and feminine in spirituality. And so I see the feminism argument in that regard. But in regards to the female characters of the book, most of them eventually stoop to manipulating both the other women in the book and the men in the book. And that's no better than the versions of the Arthurian legend where the women are just in the background and are just pawns to be used to have kids or keep the household. And so for the women to be painted as shallow, superficial, or even if they're fighting for a good cause, like for instance, Morgaine is fighting to save her way of life and her spirituality, but she stoops to doing some really terrible things in the book, and I don't think we're supposed to root for her in that regard. We're supposed to see that she's doing something, that she's going too far. So for people to say, oh, it's a classic in feminist literature, it's like, no, not really, because that paints the idea of the ugly feminist, the stereotypical feminist who hates men and or who sees things only her way and doesn't want to compromise, and that gives a bad name to feminism, and that isn't what feminism is. And again, in terms of the time period the book is set in, of course, women had limited options, and so they can only use certain tactics to get what they wanted. But just the notion of this is an example of what women can do, of what a strong woman can do. Now, I don't see that, and I don't think that the book should be held as a classic in women's literature or feminist literature in that regard. But I do think it can open doors to discussions of women's roles, both historically and now. For instance, women's spirituality now, especially along with books like The Da Vinci Code that bring up that topic of what role does the feminine divine play in modern times, and what role did it play historically? How can a more gender-balanced spirituality shape our everyday lives in terms of how men and women interact, how we interact with the environment, how we interact with ourselves, all these great deep spiritual questions. So I think the Mists of Avalon is powerful in that regard, but as far as it being a champion of feminist literature, I don't really see it in that regard, but I do see how it can open the door to discussions of women's rights and women's spirituality and those things. One of my favorite moments from the miniseries and the book occurs at the end of the story, and without giving too much away, Morgaine is left as the only survivor of her faith, of her spirituality. She's the only one left who still worships the goddess, who still dwells in Avalon, and she's in complete despair and is thinking, I'm all alone, I'm the only one left, the goddess has been forgotten, what do I do? And she wanders into the local chapel and she sees a little girl praying before a statue of the Virgin Mary. And she realizes, no, the goddess hasn't been forgotten, hasn't been left behind. She's just taken on a new incarnation and she's still here. No matter what form we look for her in, she'll be there, whether we see her as the great goddess, as Caradwyn, the great goddess, as the maiden, the mother, the crone, whether we see her as the Virgin Mary, whether we see her as simply Mother Earth, she'll always be there. And that's one of my favorite images, and that perfectly sums up the story of spiritual tolerance and looking for the divine in no matter what names or faces we put to the divine, those may change, but the divine is always there. So those are my thoughts on the Mists of Avalon. Have you read it? Are you going to read it? What are your thoughts? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you for watching. Namaste, blessed be, and happy reading. Bye.